title is Why is not Europe recovering? Perfect, because this is the question, you know. Which is the picture now? If you look at the world picture, it's so clear, you know. World economy is growing 3%, 3.1 average. Not bad, not so fantastic, but not bad. China, 7.4, 7.5. There is this big dispute, you know, of 0.1. I don't know why, but anyway. India, 5.4. Africa, 4.2. US, 1.9, 2, depends. Japan, maybe 2. Europe, minus 0.8. You know, this is already the picture. But, in spite of that, we have to, a starting point, Europe is still number one with US in GDP, but number one in industrial production, number one in export. And so it's still the giant in world economy. But in the dynamics, is negative or zero. We start with the political explanation and we'll end with the political explanation because in my opinion, you will see policy is not an economic problem, it's a political problem. But anyway, when the crisis started in 2007, and everybody of us know that it started from the United States, you know, I don't blame US, but it was not certainly a crisis starting from Europe. There was an immediate reaction of the American government. You remember that immediately Obama has taken a decision of injecting in the American economy $800 billion. That is a very big amount of money, you know. And immediately China put in the economy $585 billion equivalent in renminbi. And compared to the Chinese economy is even more important, you know. And Europe did not react. We have no European decision in this matter. European, you know, also because we were confident that the crisis would have in some way been less damaging in Europe. One of the elements of this deeper crisis in Europe was also the so-called euro crisis. You know that Europe, one of the most important decisions taken by European Union was the new currency, the common currency. It was so important, you know, because I don't stress this because I was fighting for that. I give a contribution to this, but because it never happened in history to put together the currency in a peaceful way, only through a conquest or of armies, you know, and the pillars of the modern states are two, the army and the currency. And when you put together the currency, you change the nature of your state. And this was done by people who strongly believed into united Europe. It was a political choice, but Europe political environment changed. Europe has been taken by that moment by fear. Fear of Chinese competition, fear of globalization, fear of unemployment, and the new political parties, and in any countries, there was an orientation of the traditional party to be less and less pro-European. And so the problem that was in the beginning, 30 billion euros big, not manageable, not so big, you know. It became, because of hesitation of not taking the decision, it became in 4 months 10 times bigger. There is a common wisdom that, as all common wisdom, has a lot of truth, that the problem of Europe is the lack of structural reforms. Structural reforms means mobility of labor, too high taxation, and so decreased taxation, reform of public administration, and decrease of public expenditure, improvement in the banking system. I think that this is correct, but why the rate of growth is negative even in countries like Germany or Finland, in which these reforms have already been done since almost 10 years, you know. So why this crisis takes all Europe? And this does not give an explanation. And also, in many cases, many of these so-called structural reforms, as labor mobility, the real life is that the labor now in Europe is very mobile, you know, and you can fire and hire very easily, except public administration or specific cases, you know. But really, my point is why the crisis is taking also the countries with no need of structural reform. Simply, I think that the problem is a political problem. It's not an economic problem. And the new leaders have other priorities. So there is the short-term vision that I was underlying before. There is the new power of the Council, and also there is not only that, but another problem that has complicated the decision-making process, a change, a real change inside Europe power. Europe was simplifying in the public imagination, you know. Europe was an engine with two cylinders, France and Germany. In the last 15 years, progressively, the German cylinders become bigger and bigger, you know. And so now the center of power has completely changed. We have this minus 0.8, you know, and you have a situation, I promise to be very frank, you know, in which, as an economist, I don't understand it, you know. Maybe I am old-style Keynesian economist, you know, but I learned in the books, and I was teaching for 30 years, you know, that if you are like Germany now, zero growth, almost zero inflation, and a fantastic surplus in the trade balance, you can put fire in your engine, you know, because you have a lot of room to do it, you know, and Germany does not do it, you know. So the problem of leadership, that must, a power must be accompanied by leadership, you know. And in this moment, we have a fantastic German power, but not this leadership. So no decision has been taken. Well, many decisions are taken in all the summit, but technical small decisions only in the right direction, but all very, very timid, very shy, and not enough. You will ask me, there will be a major change after the German elections, exactly in 2 months' time. Today is 22nd of July, 22nd of September, there will be German election. I think that there will be no major change because this policy is deeply rooted inside the country. What about China? What about China-European relations, you know? In this particular moment, the trade between China and Europe is not in the best moment, you know. The export of China to Europe, they decreased it. And, you know, all the journalists asked me on solar energy, wine, all these disputes, you know. I have to tell you frankly, I am not worried about that. I am not worried about that because in my life I always find that 5%, around 5% of trade is under dispute, you know. And then you arm twist, you play a bit, and then you find an agreement, you know. So I do think that even in this case, China has been very intelligent. I think that we have a common interest for the future. I think strongly that China is has the necessity to transform, to enter in what I call the second Chinese industrial change. And the Chinese company to do that must become global. And I do think that for Chinese companies, much easier to start a process of globalization through Europe than through United States. Europe is a laboratory or is a museum? And so I end with the quotation of the question of one of your colleagues here in the same room. And I still think that is the most interesting political laboratory of the contemporary world. I think that this peaceful revolution needs a lot of time because it's peaceful, you know, so you need a lot of time. But I think that Europe is still a great example how to handle the political problem among old enemies, among, you know, and tragedies of history. Of course, we are in a crisis that I have not hidden the problem of the crisis, but I think that historically we are still among the protagonists of the new world that I hope will be peaceful for all of us. Thank you.
Matteo Ricci, Romano Prodi, thank you very much. Grazie mille.